Hello, welcome to CineWatch Live. This is a brand new podcast based around all things TV and film. In this podcast, me and a couple of friends will be discussing everything Hollywood, from our 100 favourite films of all time to the latest releases. And with me today are Craig and Sophie.
Hello.
Thank you for having us.
That's all right.
I'm not thanking you.
Okay, thank you. We also want to apologise for the quality of the voice, because we are all in quarantine, so it may sound a bit odd because we're doing it over a call. We're going to start with a bit of news. Just some quick news. Killing Eve has been brought forward by 2 weeks to April 12th in the US, and literally as of like an hour ago, the UK release date has been brought to April 13th, the day after. So we're finally in the UK getting it the day after, like Game of Thrones, Walking Dead are shown, whereas we used to get it like 2 months later, a month later. So that's good news for the UK. Wonder Woman's been delayed until August 14th. Filming on the Batman has stopped indefinitely. Disney Plus, of course, released in Europe. And since their subscriptions have gone up 3 times their average amount during quarantine. So I guess Disney are loving that. They're loving quarantine in the weirdest way. Michael Biehn to star in The Mandalorian Season 2. He's rumoured to play a bounty hunter. Not too sure. I think, Craig, you said something about that.
Yeah, well, he's quite famous from, like, the late 80s and kind of early 90s for starring in The Terminator and Aliens. So to see him kind of come back to big screen, well, not big screen, but come see him back in a big role, supposedly, again. So I think that might draw quite a lot of people back to The Mandalorian, especially after the rumour that once Mandalorian ended in the US, a lot of subscription rates at Disney Plus went down. This could be a draw to other people.
Yeah, that's... yeah. Rosario Dawson as well, rumoured to play Ahsoka Tano in The Mandalorian Season 2.
Oh my god. I think that's amazing casting if it's true.
Yeah. Minions, The Rise of Gru, delayed indefinitely. If anybody cares about that at this point, that's the 5th Despicable Me film. I think Despicable Me...
actually, I had no idea that was the thing.
Is it the 5th? Jesus.
It's the 5th, yeah, it's the 5th film, because they did 3 Despicable Me's and 1 Minions, and now this is the 2nd Minions. And they're going to ride off it, so, you know...
they will.
Trolls World Tour is coming to digital on April 6th worldwide, as it was obviously delayed. DreamWorks decided we'll release it on digital. Well, there we go. So... today, in the first episode, we thought we would go through, over the course of 10 episodes, our top 100 films of all time. These are our favourite films, or some that may have a large influence on the industry, that's why the reason they are our favourites. So these aren't us saying that these are the best films of all time. In terms of Craig, it might be him saying they are the best films of all time.
I don't think some of these are the best films of all time.
All right. But they're our favourites, at least.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
We're going to start, and I think, Sophie, you can start, if you want, with your 100. We're going to get straight into it.
Alrighty. So my 100 is the film Holes by Andrew Davis.
Which is Tommy Shire, but...
I am pretty sure it is, yeah. It was a childhood film. I really loved it.
Is it the one based on the book where they dig holes, or... treasure.
I have a funny story about Holes. I don't know if this is the film, but is this the film where there's a scene where they're by the pool and there's a group of girls in bikinis?
No.
Okay.
No, 100% not that.
Is that the hole or is that Holes? Is that Holes or the hole? Oh, that's the hole. Okay, because there's a scene in that film that's like really like just weird. Yeah. Anyway, moving on. Craig, what is your 100?
Okay, my 100 is this film called The Burbs. It's set in the suburbs of America. Sorry, Tom Hanks. I can't remember what the year was, but it's about these people who think their neighbours are murderers, and it's kind of them trying to figure out whether they are or not. And it's quite, I think found it quite funny. I don't think it got very high scores, like when it came out and stuff, but I don't know, I quite liked it and I've watched it many times. So
I've not actually seen it. Sophie, have you seen it?
I have not, but I'm always up for a film with Tom Hanks in it.
But Tom Hanks and Carrie Fisher in.
Nice.
Yeah. Wait, would you say it was called The Birds?
Burbs.
B-U-R-B-S.
Oh, the bird. Okay. I thought you said The Birds. I was like, wait, Tom Hanks was in The Birds? I'm pretty sure it wasn't.
No, that's a Hitchcock classic.
Yeah.
I don't think I have a Hitchcock on my list. No, I do.
You do too?
I don't actually have a Hitchcock on my list. My list is like probably the most worst compared to yours, in terms of taste, at least.
Everybody speaks to their own, you know?
Well, yeah, exactly. That's the whole thing. My 100... is La Haine, which is The Hate, which is, of course, a French film, 1995, black and white. I was first introduced to this when I was studying French, and, yeah, I just really enjoyed it. It's like a sort of a piece on sort of society at the time. Have any of you guys seen it?
Yes,
no, I have not.
You have? Sophie, what do you think of it?
I thought it was quite good. I think I'm thinking of the right film, but yes. Very good for a French film. I'm joking, but
French film. Oh, all right, French films are very good actually. Like I have a couple of. I have three French films on my list.
Yeah, I said that, but I am checking over my list, and I do have quite. I have at least two French films, so I take that back. Apologies.
I don't think I have a French film on my list. Surprisingly, I do have other language films, but I don't have only French. Interesting.
Yeah. Well.
No, I've never seen French though. So you guys have been. Exposed to the French language more often.
I'd agree. Two of the films on my list all three came from when I was studying French, so you know.
Yeah.
That's just how it is. Who wants to say their 99? Sophie, what did you get for 99? I think you guys are gonna be quite short. This is on my 99 is. Mine's quite
My 99 is the film Nine by Shane Acker. It's a animated film. I don't know if you've seen it.
Oh, I know what you mean. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
It's set like in a sort of dystopian thing.
I found it quite creepy when I first watched it. I think I still find it creepy, even though it's a children's film. But it's kind of like Coraline.
Yeah, I quite like that when I saw it. Quite wild. Is it Elijah Wood the main character?
Take a look.
No, I quite liked that when it first.
I remember
the marketing being quite creepy because, obviously, we were younger when it came out, and I saw marketing around like places, and it was all kind of creepy and dystopian and a bit spooky. But obviously, it was an animated film, so it wasn't going to be too scary. But I just remember seeing like the man. He's got the little lamp.
I remember that poster.
Yeah,
quite a good poster.
I still need to see it, to be fair. There's a lot of films I haven't seen.
But that's quite good.
Yeah.
Well,
what's your 99, Craig?
Mine is Dawn of the Planet of the Apes. So not the first in the trilogy of the new ones, but the middle one.
Yeah.
Which personally, I find my favourite. Just because I found the third one to be quite too actiony for my taste, and the first one to be a bit too not whimsical, but a bit.
I felt there was a very different tone to all three.
Yeah,
I get what you mean.
One, where the second one felt like it was more humans and monkeys like surviving together rather than against each other, and then eventually, you know, becoming slaves in the films later on, the originals, but. Yeah, I quite like that one the most out of the three because it had more thought-provoking themes and stuff, which were always more interesting to watch than just monkeys shooting humans and humans shooting monkeys.
I think I personally preferred the first one, but I don't know. I felt like the closing sequence of the first one was really good as well.
Oh yeah, on the Golden Gate Bridge.
Yeah,
that was good.
And I don't know, I felt like there was like an emotional response as well with Caesar and the main character, forgot his name.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Green Goblin by Amanda Films.
Yeah, exactly. James Franco. Well, that's, yeah.
James Franco, that's it, yeah.
Yeah, James Franco.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. But it's interesting you talk about that as well, because I actually, I came up with 113 films when I was doing my list, and obviously I had to get rid of some, and I actually chose to take sequels out, because I had trilogies in there, and I was like, for example, I had like the original Star Wars trilogy, and I sort of picked out of them three, which was my absolute favourite, and sort of kept that one in, just because right. I had to narrow it down, but yeah, I do have some sequels in there, though, yeah. I think. But yeah. My 99 is, and I hope some of you have seen this, Notes on a Scandal, which I love. It stars Kate Blanchett and Judi Dench. It's a British film, and it's just brilliant. I mean, I don't want to spoil it, but it's basically about two separate things. It's about Judi Dench plays this teacher at a school, and Kate Blanchett joins the school, and Kate Blanchett has a family and everything, and Judi Dench sort of comes in and like actually has an obsession with her, sort of like a, not even just a sexual obsession, it's like a, she just wants to control her. And then she finds out that Kate Blanchett's character has actually been having an affair with a student, and then it like it all changes there, and like she uses that to control her, and it's just very, you know, it's just different and fun to watch, I'd say, anyway.
I've not seen it, but I'm fully up for watching that, actually. It sounds quite good.
Yeah, it does sound interesting. I haven't seen it either. I haven't heard of it either as well.
Yeah, no, it's other films, but I'd seen it like on TV like last year, and it just came on late at night, and it's one of those films and you think, oh, they're usually like gonna be rubbish, but it was actually really good, and it was like yeah, it was just, you know, I like a good British film as well, so I guess that's that.
Yeah, totally.
Anyway,
oh, yeah. No, I
think
it's about
what? 98. What do you have, Sophie?
My 98 is Liar Liar with Jim Carrey in it.
Never heard of it.
No, absolutely.
The thingy, the lawyer, and he's.
Yes, and he can never tell a lie.
Yeah.
I think it's quite a funny film. I think it's quite a feel good film. It's kind of a Sunday evening watch.
Yeah,
yeah.
I know what you mean about them.
Yeah, Liar Liar. Fully recommend it.
Solid what?
Craig?
Mine is a Michael Bay film called The Rock. I think it's by Michael. Yeah, it's by Michael Bay. And it stars Nicolas Cage and Sean Connery. And it's about them trying to break into Alcatraz. And it's quite good. I quite liked it anyway. It's an action film, but
again, I've never heard of it.
It's not Michael Bay with the big explosions and all that. It's actually a bit more controlled. So,
controlled Michael Bay film?
Yeah, I know. Shocking, right?
I mean, Transformers. Let's not lie.
Hang on a second.
Transformers. That's a controlled film.
Yeah, sure.
I'll move on to mine before we get on to Transformers. Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Oh shit! Really?
Snow White.
Oh no.
Snow White. Wow.
Snow White. Just because, right? It's only one of my favorites because it's so influential on the animated film like industry, because it was the first feature length film and one of the first. It was actually, I think it was, wasn't it like the first animated film to have color as well, and with voice match, and it was like, it was just so. I just can't imagine at that time having that. I mean, I guess for us, that's sort of like how we had IMAX. Obviously, we sort of take IMAX for granted, but I guess for that was so different. Do you know what I mean? Like, to get a feature-length animated film, and for children, this was, like, revolutionary, because this has paved the way for the ones we have today, like Toy Story and Up and all that. And it's like, you know, Lawrence, Prince of Arabia, I don't know what else to say. It was just, and when I watched it, I guess it's not my favourite Disney film of all time, but it's just that influential that I thought I can't leave it out. But obviously it is quite far back in my list at 98. So I don't know. But yeah.
I get what you mean. I mean, yeah, it must have had like a huge influence on it. So yeah.
Yeah. Well.
Yeah. Good little film.
97.
My 97 is Saw, the first Saw film.
Oh, nice.
I'm going wrong with a good Saw film.
Yeah.
Wait, is that the one where they're in the bathroom and they're all chained up?
Yes.
I actually like that one. It's the only one I've seen, but I like. And I've seen Jigsaw actually, but yeah.
Jigsaw
was alright.
Yeah,
it wasn't the best one. I quite like the one where it opens with his head in the glass tank. I don't know whether that's 5 or 6. And he's got
can't remember.
His throat so he can breathe. That one was quite.
Which one? They've made so many Saw films, they all kind of merge into one.
Saw 9 is where, if it comes out.
That's been delayed as well, hasn't it?
Yeah. Because Jigsaw was 8, and this Spiral, the book from Saw.
Yeah, Spiral.
So Samuel L. Jackson.
Yeah.
Where did that come
from? I mean, didn't Chris Rock write and direct it as well? Or did he at least write it?
I think he co-wrote it or something like that, yeah. Don't think
he directed. Oh, fair enough. I mean, yeah. Any other thoughts on Saw? I mean, for me personally, it's like, I know it's meant to be a horror film, but I personally found that, that's the only one I've seen, and I actually found it quite funny. I don't know why, it was just like,
yeah, it's not as brutal as everyone thinks it is. It gets brutaler near the end. But
yeah. It's very like, because like you say, like half the film, they're just sat there, and it's like having to work things out, and it's sort of like, playing with everyone's minds, and that's very like sort of an intellectual horror in a way, not like the most intellectual, but do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It makes people think throughout the film.
Yeah.
Good choice. My 97. It's interesting, Brad, that you put a Disney film at 98 because I have a Disney 7, and that's Aladdin, the original live action.
The original. So not the.
Do you have to say I have never seen Aladdin?
Okay, get
You've
out.
You've never seen Aladdin? Wow.
I'm not a massive Disney fan.
You don't even need to be a Disney fan to see Aladdin. Aladdin was like the...
No, I know.
But... Even though it had Princess Jasmine, it was like the boys... Finally, like the boys Disney... Like, this was before The Lion King as well, so it was like the boys Disney film. You know, they'd just come off The Little Mermaid in 1989. 1992, here comes Aladdin with Robin Williams, one of the first big names to work with Disney. And then,
he is amazing.
Yeah, I mean, I watched on Disney Plus, actually, a documentary called The Imagineering Story and One Day at Disney. They were both different documentaries. I can't remember which one it was in. But in One Day at Disney, they actually had the designer that designed Aladdin and the genie. And he said he actually got to work with Robin Williams and actually designed to Robin Williams. So Robin Williams came in and he designed the genie to Robin Williams' like voice. And everything, so it's like, it's quite actually a good documentary, I'm not going to lie, like, you can say what you want about, you know, what you will about Disney Plus, but the documentaries on there are actually quite good, and you sort of realise, like, I had this thing about Disney that I was sort of like, oh, it's a really bad company, blah, 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 but you got to think, like, the people that are working in it in today's day are working so hard, and it's not, they're not a reflection of what Walt was and how he was towards people. That's just a side note, I know, but I just thought I'd say because, yeah, it was just interesting as well about the whole Aladdin thing, how he designed it. This guy was working on British, he was actually in England. He was designing adverts, animation adverts. He had his own company, and then sort of he was spotted at an animation convention by Disney, and they took him on, and he designed Aladdin. He's designed loads of more as well. I think he designed Frozen as well, which is, you know, yeah.
Oh, cool.
Anyway, my 97 is American History X. I did enjoy it, but it's so low on the list just because when I think of all these films that I enjoyed, I didn't enjoy it as much as others. Not because of like the reviews held in it or anything. I just it's such a different film to everything else I'd ever seen before, do you know what I mean?
Yeah, it's quite not intense, but it's quite, you need to stay focused throughout it because it's quite, there's a lot to it.
Yeah,
that
yeah.
Like,
it's just, I don't know, it was just, I can't even describe, do you know, it's one of those films you can't describe, you have to see it, but you don't necessarily know why.
Yeah.
It's like...
Yeah, no, it's good, and the performances are good as well.
Yeah, and like, this was sort of peak Ed Norton as well, I think, like...
Yeah. It really was, yeah.
Yeah. Obviously now he's... I think he was in Motherless Brooklyn this year, but I don't think that was received that well. I don't know.
Well, he's apparently quite difficult to work with. That's why he's not been in a lot of film.
Yeah.
But this is him back when he was given this and there's Fight Club and
other
films in them all. But he was kind of becoming popular back in the late 90s, early 2000s, and then... kind of real standout that it was kind of difficult to work with. You try and change the script, try and tell the directors how to direct, all that sort of thing. So it was quite, like, he slowly got cyberpunk, you know, really cool.
I mean, obviously there's the famous whole story about how the Incredible Hulk, he stopped being because of how hard he was to work with. So, you know, that puts your point to proves it, really.
I never knew that.
You never knew about the Incredible Hulk?
I never knew that he was that difficult to work with.
No. 96.
My 96 is the animated film Rango.
Ooh, oh, I've never seen it.
Which I actually watched last night. It is on Netflix.
I love that film. That's not on my list. I really should have probably put that on there. I love Rango so much.
It's such a good film.
Never seen it. Yeah.
Wow. Well, you need to go and watch it because it's on there. You've got no excuse.
Yeah, that's true. Now we're in quarantine. I need to...
Yeah.
I still haven't watched... Hero that you lent me.
Oh, come on. So you watched Old Boy?
I have not watched Old Boy yet. I need to do that, Craig. Sorry.
Been giving out these DVDs, but there's no, you know.
No viewing.
Yeah, Craig is our personal blockbuster.
Yeah, I'm the only person keeping it alive. Stealing out my back garden.
You know the blockbuster you saw in Captain Marvel? That was Craig's.
That's my hat.
That is his house. Anyway, Craig's 96 is
Fight Club.
Oh, okay, fair enough. Mine is Fight Club. I have Fight Club. It's further down. Okay, fair enough. Why 96?
I don't know. I quite like Fight Club, but I don't know. I think something about it is it's sometimes it feels a bit too pretentious, and it seems like it's acting. I know this is ridiculous to say, but it feels like it acts like it's better than. A lot of people hold it in high regard, but it's not as good the second or third time watching it. But it's still a good film, don't get me wrong. But personally, I just think it's more kind of higher end of my list, not in the 20s or whatever. But it's still a good film.
I've only seen it once. I haven't seen it more than once. I don't know.
Yeah, because once you see it, like, obviously I'm not going to spoil what happens in it, but all the things that happen in it, it's not as interesting to watch the second time.
Yeah, you know, I know you mean, yeah,
like
yeah.
It only needs the one-time viewing.
Yeah, I guess I'll keep it that way then.
You can watch it again, it's not a problem, but...
Yeah, but I could watch that again or I could watch something completely new, do you know what I mean? So.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Yeah. My 96 is... I was going to say a personal favourite, but all of these 100 are a personal favourite, so that makes no sense. But my 96 is Carol. Anybody seen Carol?
I love that film.
Carol's great, isn't it?
It's a nice film.
I never really particularly liked it as much as I guess you guys did.
No, I just think it's one of those films that's like it's not even like a full on drama. It's just a nice sit down and watch it, sort of. Yeah, it's just, do you know what I mean? I think it's a nice feel good film. Not feel good in like super bad feel good, but it's feel good in. It's just, I don't know, Cate Blanchett for me, she's a great performer, I think, personally.
Yeah, you can't be wrong.
That's Carol. Anyway, 95.
My 95 is I'm Legend with Will Smith in it.
Oh, yeah. I haven't seen it.
Again, good film.
Apocalypse
film.
I've seen bits of it.
Surprisingly sad. It gets sad, you know. But, you know.
If it's something to do with the dog, I don't want to watch it. Dog films.
Can't make a comment about that.
Oh, God.
I'm not going to say anything.
I don't want to know. I don't want to know.
Then don't watch it.
I probably will watch it at some point. I watched Togo yesterday, and the dog, like, not to spoil anything, but the dog dies. And, yeah.
Not to spoil anything.
To be honest, were any of you going to watch Togo?
No.
Exactly. So, you know. Anyway, Craig, what's your 95?
My 95 is the classic Halloween. Not even remake, the weird sequel remake.
First one.
The original classic, yeah. The classic directed by Jim Carpenter. Because the theme song at the start, the opening, everything about Michael Myers being an iconic killer, it's just still stands up now as a great horror film. And the performances and everything, it's really good.
It's so good.
It's interesting that you have that on your list, because I, when I was deciding between, like I said earlier, like the sequels and stuff, I had both Halloween 2018 and 90, is it 79 or something?
78, I think.
78, yeah, I had both of them on my list. I actually chose the 2018 one, but...
Oh, yeah, I mean, the 2018 one is good. It's still really good.
Yeah.
But I don't know, something about the feel of the original being, like, nostalgic.
Yeah, I know what you're saying. That tracking shot as well, the opening tracking shot.
Yeah.
Yeah. And obviously, that was influential for its time as well, because like the tracking shot hadn't been used that much. And yeah, especially in horror as well.
And the reveal at the end of the tracking shot that actually you're following like a 6-year-old child.
Yeah, exactly.
And it's not, but like, you think it's an adult breaking into the house, but it's actually just like 6-year-old murdering his sister. Just like, whoa. And then it just starts with that like really good theme song.
Yeah, yeah. Mine is Moon.
Oh, Moon with
That's
Rockwell.
That's my 95.
Rockwell.
Moon. Yeah, I've really enjoyed Moon.
It's a good film.
What to say about Moon? Well, yeah. I mean, we can't really say much about Kevin Spacey now, can we?
Why not?
Let's just say the other actor in the film was the voice actor in the film. We won't discuss, but Sam Rockwell, I think, can be... He's usually a secondary actor, but I think in that, he proved that he can be a mainstay actor, you know? But...
Yeah, Sam Rockwell's a good actor, that's the thing, like... But he's never really given main starring roles, he's always more supporting.
Yeah, but...
that's what he won the Oscar for.
We don't want to get Sophie started on Sam Rockwell.
Alright, guys, it's Tim Roth and Sam Rockwell, that's who you got to look out for.
Oh, God. Not spoiler alert, I have Moon on my list as well, but it's slightly lower.
Spoiler alert too, I also have Moon on my list.
Yeah.
You guys put it higher, I put it, fair enough.
Yes.
I mean, I think you might
not much though, mine's not far away.
I think you might like my next one, but obviously you guys do yours first, and then
94?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is Bugsy Malone.
Really?
Oh.
Yeah. I absolutely love that film. Absolutely love it.
You know what? It's another one I haven't seen. I need to see all these classic films. I've seen more modern films.
So good. My dad showed it to me and I love it.
I don't know. When I watched it obviously a while ago. I was much younger when I watched it. Something about it just didn't really click. I can see why people like it because it's entertaining, but it never really stuck to me. It's like a classic. My 94 pick is a film called Lars and the Real... it stars Ryan Gosling, not Ryan Gosling.
Lars and the Real what?
And it's about... Lars and the Real Girl.
Lars and the Real Girl, okay.
And it's it stars him, Ryan Gosling, and he's kind of socially awkward. And it sounds weird, the plot, but it's actually really worth watching. He orders a sex doll offline, like a life-size sex doll, and starts dating it.
Christ.
But it's really, like, everyone in the town, because he lives in this small town, like, everyone in the town accepts it, because he's quite socially awkward, he can't really talk to people, and he thinks it's this real girl, and he talks to him, he puts it to bed and takes it out in a wheelchair, and he doesn't, like, have sex with it, he says he's saving it until married. It's quite a nice film, because it's about him and his brother, who's played by, Brad will know this, the actor who plays Mark Brandanowitz, who's his brother in this film.
All right, yeah.
From Parks and Rec. Yeah.
Mark Brandanowitz, the worst character of Parks and Rec to ever have lived.
All right, controversial, but I agree.
Everyone agrees.
Maybe not so controversial.
We hate you, Mark.
But, all right. Brutal. But, yeah, it's just a nice film. I highly recommend it. It's on Amazon Prime. I watched it last year. And, worth watch, yeah.
My 94 is The Founder, which I love. I love all of these, but I love The Founder. It is the biopic of how McDonald's was created. Now, granted, it might take it a bit out of hand, and it might lie about a few things, but it is basically, I think you can agree, Craig, like, on the right tracks. And
yeah,
it's like,
good film.
It's amazing. I find it's how it was amazing how, like, literally these two brothers started McDonald's. They are the name McDonald's. They were the McDonald's brothers. Yet this one guy swoops in and literally takes the whole business from under their feet. It was crazy. Yeah. But I don't know. I enjoyed that personally. It has Michael Keaton in it?
Yeah,
Michael Keaton's in it, who I thought he did a great performance, personally.
Nick Offerman is one of the brothers.
Is he?
Yeah.
Oh my god, Ron Swanson. Brothers. You heard it here first. Ron Swanson is one of the brothers.
Ron Swanson making burgers.
It literally sounds like him. I watched that episode of Parks and Rec where he does the barbecue that Leslie would usually do. And then, like, he gets really angry because they're all, like, coming up to him, like, Ron, when is it? And, like, he tries to make them eat that live pig. It's great. Parks and Rec. People should watch Parks and Rec. I know it's a TV show, but it's a great TV show. Some say better than The Office. I say better than The Office.
Ooh, that's controversial.
That's more controversial.
Yeah, but do you know what? It is funnier, though. The Office is hilarious, but Parks and Rec just gets it.
I don't know what it is, but I just love The Office. Just so good.
This is quite funny.
Yeah, I guess. Anyway, 93.
Right, my number 93 is absolute classic, E.T.
Ooh. Oh. Mine is higher up the list for E.T., but alright.
I don't even have that on the list.
No, it's a classic. You got to have it on your list. I mean, obviously, if it's not one of your favourites.
Film, love it.
But
I'm gonna say it here. Here's a proper controversial opinion. I don't like E.T.
Ooh.
I said it.
Get out of this podcast.
These controversial opinions everywhere.
It's just this episode is all about controversial opinions today.
It is. You heard it here first. Craig does not like E.T.
Yeah, I'm happy to take that to the grave. I might rewatch it later, but I never liked it the times that I watched it. Just, I don't know, it just always was a bit boring.
I agree, at times it is. But I just think, I don't know. It's alright.
Cute.
It's not that bad.
Looks a bit like Brad's mum, but...
Thank you. I think he just looks a bit like me. Sophie, I don't know why you're laughing.
Why did you put it on your list then?
Why did I put E.T. on my list? Because it's a classic, and it's a film from my childhood. I think the majority of these lists this section of the list is films from my childhood, because I watched them and I'm just like, this is a really, like, feel-good film.
In your childhood?
Yes, no. A majority of them, I didn't say. This is why I'm the way I am.
When he said, you want to play a game, that really stuck with you because you like playing jigsaw.
To this day, I stick by that.
Yeah.
like E.T. because it's a feel-good film.
Yeah, it's a good film. I like E.T. Well, I don't at all. I don't know why I did that.
Stop going back on it.
my 93rd film, is the... film that probably none of you have heard of. It's not like we studied it or anything. It's Pan's Labyrinth.
Oh, Pan's Labyrinth. That is not even
Pan's
on my
Labyrinth.
List.
I just like Pan's Labyrinth so much. It stuck to me. Obviously, not that long that we've studied it, but it just kind of one of them films that we've...
We are all film students and we had to study Pan's Labyrinth.
Yeah.
Coronavirus means that we no longer have to write about Pan's Labyrinth, but we do have to study Pan's Labyrinth. Pan's Labyrinth, also... an honorary subject of our list of the top films that have gruesome killings of kids.
God,
you guys are sick and twisted individuals.
Sophie does not agree with the list.
I don't see what's the problem. This list is crucial because when a film kills a kid, is it not a lot more badass?
It also shows that the creator has had control over the film.
Exactly.
Not many films are going to be easy to market or whatever when you kill a kid.
No, but they make it when it has the balls to kill a kid, it's like, whoa, okay, this film is trying to mean something.
Making a statement.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it's good.
Anyway.
Like when a kid get killed, brutally murdered, love it. Quality content.
Good film, Pan's Labyrinth, though. One of my top foreign films. 93rd for me is Hell or High Water.
Oh, yeah. I haven't seen that. Is that...
I haven't seen it either, but I've heard of it.
At the time I watched it on Prime, whether it still is on Prime, I don't know. This is Prime UK, not Prime US. It may be on Prime US, but it was on Prime. Not sure, though. But it stars Jeff Bridges and, I believe, is it Chris Pine? I want to say Chris Pine, but I don't think it is. Who else is
I've just Googled it. It is Chris Pine.
Yeah. Oh, it is Chris Pine. Yeah. It's sort of a... It's very similar to My 92. I won't lie. They're both westerns. It's a western that's not conventional western, but it shows them aspects.
Do you love a good western?
Yeah, I think you know what. Oh yeah, you know what My 92 is. But yeah,
I think Sophie should know it as well, but don't.
Yeah.
I have an inkling, but anyway.
92 for you, Sophie, is.
My 92 is Halloween. So I agree with Craig, just mine's a little higher up.
Classic.
Yeah, classic Halloween.
Oh, okay. Well,
yeah.
We've discussed Halloween.
Yep.
We can move on to Craig's.
Okay, my 92 is a classic. Hopefully you've seen it, both of you. The Breakfast Club.
Yes, The Breakfast Club. On my list, higher up, but still, yeah, love The Breakfast Club.
Breakfast Club's so good. Just there's something about it, it's just so... It resonates with me, especially the more times I've watched it, the older I've got. Like, it's just more... I've connected more with it.
Yeah, I know what you mean. What else you need to say? It's like... It's one of those, again, one of those feel-good films, one of those ones that really resonates with teens. I think it was like sort of like, people don't really talk about it, but there was a very much, in the 80s, with films obviously like Breakfast Club, Sweet 16, Say Anything, sort of...
Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
There was sort of that teen appeal to all those films, sort of a renaissance for teen films, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, I think you guessed it, but my 92 is No Country for Old Men.
Yeah.
Again, a western that isn't conventionally a western, but it is a western. We're studying it. I actually didn't really like it the first time I watched it before we started studying it, but since we started studying it. Yeah. Since we started studying it,
I enjoyed it.
I've actually been like, I really like this film. I don't know about you guys, but I didn't like it first, now I do.
See, it's interesting, on my list as well, lower down, but I didn't like it the second time I watched it with you guys in film. I still like it in the film, but it's the first time I watched it with more, had more impact than the second time.
Yeah.
Because it's quite long as well, and it's like, not much happens, so when you know the plot of it, it doesn't have as much of an impact, but the behind the scenes and the making of it and the cinematography and everything and the sound design is sure.
Cinematography so in that film?
Yeah. Wow.
Fantastic.
Obviously Roger Deakins, who did 1917 as well. And Blade
Runner 2049.
Yeah. He's one of my inspirations as a cinematographer, I'm not going to lie.
Good.
But yeah. So we're now into the final ones of today's episode, 91. Do you want to go straight ahead, Sophie, and tell us what your final one of today is?
My 91, I'm not entirely sure if either of you have seen it. I've watched it because it is based off of a graphic novel, and I adore graphic novels. The Losers.
No.
Oh, yeah. That's the one with Zoe Saldana, who played Gamora.
Yes. and Jeffrey Dean Morgan and Chris Evans. And, yeah.
It's quite the cast.
It's quite a good cast. I mean, the reviews weren't the best for it, but I enjoyed... I think it's just a good old action film, I think. And because of it being based off a graphic novel, I quite liked that as well. And it stuck quite closely to the story, so...
Yeah, I know what you mean. I
think Chris Evans playing no... Like, I seem to remember seeing the posters and he was wearing glasses or something the entire time.
He was the computer nerd, basically.
That's weird casting. Was this before Captain America as well?
I think it was. When was the first Captain America film?
2011.
Yeah, this was 2010.
Craig.
You're 91.
My 91 is Monster Inc. Oh, okay, yeah. That's,
that is on my list, but higher up. It's such a good film.
Slightly controversial maybe for you guys, because it might be quite so high on my list. It's not my favourite Pixar film, but out of all the Pixar films, it's one of the better ones, personally. I only have, like, two on my list, I think. But, yeah, it's just so... There's something about it. It's not as emotional as, say, like, Up or something like that. It's not as silly as, like, Cars or Cars 2 or anything. It just hits the balance perfectly. It's emotional right near the end when it needs to be and it wants to be. And it's also fun and lighthearted, like, the rest of the time. And it's, yeah...
I must confess, it was one of the films that I had about four Pixar films on here, because I do quite like the Pixar films. I think they're great, and I think they're good films technically anyway, but that was one of them, and I actually took it off. That was one of the 113. I took it off for others, but I do know what you mean. I know. I do love Monsters, Inc., though. I won't lie. It just didn't make my top 100 favourites. But now I'm thinking about it. You know, like, now you're saying, you guys are saying films, I'm thinking, actually, could I replace one with that? But yeah, no, I won't replace any, but... That was, yeah, I agree. It's great.
It's a very good film.
I really liked it. My 91 is, now, it's sort of, for me, controversial, because I'm not a big war film lover, but I sort of was told to watch this and actually liked it a bit. Saving Private Ryan.
Oh, that is also on my list. I like that.
Yeah,
I forgot about that film.
It's so low on my list.
I've forgotten about it.
Yeah, because that's probably the reason why it's so low on my list, because it's quite forgettable. I'm not really personally anyway a war film person, and I don't know, it's just, I don't know.
I like it, but I've just forgotten to put it on my list. I probably wouldn't put it any lower than you have either. Like, it's a good film, but I think the opening 20 minutes really saves it more than anything else, but when they're storming the beach at the start.
Yeah, it does, yeah,
quite
yeah.
Controversial, I put it up quite high on the list.
Wow, your choice.
I mean...
To respect all opinions, even if they're wrong, but...
And that is a fact.
Yeah.
Just as well, does anyone have any honourable mentions? Like, I obviously have Monsters, Inc., Scott Pilgrim vs. the World, that never ended up on my list.
That ended up on my list.
The original Toy Story is an honourable mention. Obviously, that has to be talked about for how influential that was for 3D animation.
Yeah, I think Toy Story is quite an honourable mention that I haven't put on here. Definitely. Yeah.
Any others?
I haven't put Up on there for me.
Yep.
Yeah, Up's on mine. Up's made it on mine, I think. Cars 2, obviously, a brilliant film. Cars 2 would probably have been number one if it wasn't for the other film that I chose.
Oh, spoilers. We've got to keep that for a while.
Hang on a second.
Yeah.
Oh.
So no, any more honorary... Even short... nominations for short films, like honorary...
I've actually got a short film on my list. I might have broken the rules a little bit, but...
No, that's fine. If it's one of your favourite films.
I've got a trilogy in one place. Fine. So...
I mean, I want to say... A short film called Une Sœur, which is a sister, another French film. Brilliant. Actually loved it. So good. Nominated for the Oscar last year, or this year. Brilliant, though. Loved that film. You guys should watch it.
What about that short film where she kills the baby? About a girl.
About a girl, yeah. That's on our badass list. That is a badass killing,
and
though.
And Swimmer.
I haven't seen Swimmer, actually.
Swimmer is one of the most beautiful short films I've ever seen. Absolutely gorgeous.
All right, Sophie.
It really is.
I only have one documentary on my list, so I'll reach out to a lot of these documentaries.
That's,
like,
yeah.
Free Solo, I don't have on here. I don't have Thread Identical Strangers, which is also another classic, recent classic as well, I'd say. People need to watch, just so amazing.
Yeah.
I don't know the runtime, but potentially... You could put that Michael Jackson documentary. They were only an hour an episode, weren't they? They were only two.
Oh, yeah.
So, kind of in the film length.
I was going to put, I think, Amy on my list, but then I decided not to. And Maradona, obviously, Capadia films, and Bowling for Columbine. I didn't put on my list either. But I actually enjoyed. I went into Bowling for Columbine thinking, oh, I don't really like this documentarian. I don't really like his stuff. I actually liked it. So yeah. One film I will not recommend is Kurt and Courtney by Nick Broomfield. It's not good. It's rubbish. There is no point to it.
One honourable mention I'll put on my list, really came close to taking no one's spot, and then they decided to take it out at the last second, was Winter's Bone.
Winter's Bone. What? We don't mean that literally. We mean that absolutely not literally. Winter's Bone is horrible. You know,
it's none of us liked it. I don't know anyone who likes it.
I don't know how it achieved critical acclaim, if I'm honest with you.
Yeah.
If you're brave enough to admit you like it, come see me, because I'll probably punch you.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's from all of us. Yeah, this podcast don't waste no time. If you like Winter's Bone, this ain't the podcast for you. We don't want no boners over here.
Oh.
Anyway, I think that is it for today's episode. Next episode, we'll obviously do 90 to 81. I have some interesting ones on there.
I do too.
Yeah, that featured today, actually, I have on there. I actually have some horror films on there.
Yeah, same.
That will be out very soon after this episode. So we will see you guys next time.